Siapa Sopi tadi? Sopi.
Dokter Alamia, Head Department of Accounting, Dr. Yeni Sabri, spesialis itu menguatkan.
Oh, okay, yeah. See you next time. She is still in Malang, really?
Oh yeah.
Yes, Jawa Timur.
Okay. Itu kok les cek? Kok potret? Ana, apa Rini? Oh.
Ini besar.
Pak Mustafa and join us. Assalamualaikum Pak Mustafa.
Enggak ada live.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Rini.
Terima kasih Pak Mustafa sudah bergabung. Baik, kita berikan kepada Ananda para panitia persilakan.
Kita mulai Bu. Baik Bu. Dimohon kepada para peserta webinar untuk menghidupkan kameranya.
Cuma separuh ya.
Jauh pulau dari Malaka, pergi haji ke kota Mekah. Dengan bismillah acara saya buka, semoga acara mendapat berkah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
First of all, praise and gratitude we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has given us the blessing of healthy and the opportunity to be present today at the international webinar of First of all, praise and gratitude we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has given us the blessing of health and the opportunity to be present today at the international webinar of Accounting Fair 4, Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting. Peace be upon to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the last messenger from Allah who has guided human life from distraction into the right way of Islam. The Honorable Lecturer of KEMNS International Islamic University Malaysia, Mrs. Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj. The Honorable Deputy Dean 3 of the Faculty of Economics and Islamic Business, State Islamic University of North Sumatra, Mr. Dr. Mustafa Kamal Rokan MH. The Honorable Head Department of Sharia Accounting, Mrs. Dr. Hajjah Yeni Samri Julieti Nasution MA. The Honorable Secretary Department of Sharia Accounting, Mr. Hendra Harmain SEMPD. The Honorable Mr. and Mrs. Lecturer of the Faculty of Economics and Islamic Business, State Islamic University of North Sumatra, and the guests who attended. The Honorable General Chairman of the Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting 2021 till 2022, Muhammad Izitama. The Honorable Chairman of the Committee for Accounting 4, Dafa Ulhaq. The Honorable All Management of Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting, and the Honorable All Attendees. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Askar Ayani. It is an awesome and precious change for me to be your master of ceremony in this morning on Saturday, 4th of December 2021, in our big event, International Webinar of Accounting Fair 4, with them Sharia Accounting as the driving force of Islamic finance in the development of the Islamic economic world. Shorten the time. Before we start our agenda for today, they will be reciting the Holy Quran, who will be recited by Khairul Faiz Batubara. To Khairul Faiz Batubara, time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَافْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَإِذَا قِيلَ انشُزُوا فَانشُزُوا يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تعملون خبير صدق الله العظيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم
Thank you to Khairul Faiz Batubara who has read the Holy Verse Quran. The next agenda, singing the Indonesian Raya Anthem, State Islamic University of North Sumatra Anthem, and Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting Anthem.
Thank you.
Jamiatul Islamiyah Al-Qumiyah Sumpah Roti Asyamadiyah Islami University No Sumatera Kuri Sumatera Utara Pusat pengembangan kita dan seni Berlandaskan Quran dan Sunnah Pancasila Undang-Undang Dasar Masyarakat sejahtera bersama mungkin bangkitkan jiwa raga bersama harumkan Sumatera Utara bersama mungkin sejayakan Indonesia bersama bangun peradaban dunia Al-Jamiatul
The next agenda is speech by the chairman of the Committee for Accounting Fair 4, Dafa Ul Haq. To Dafa Ul Haq, please, time is yours.
Mohon maaf sebelumnya, Kak, ini suaranya kedengar nggak?
Dengar.
Kedengaran, Bang.
The Honorable Lecturer of Kuliah Economic and Management Science of International Islamic University of Malaysia as the speaker in this international webinar, Mrs. Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj, the Honorable Deputy Dean 3 of the Faculty of Economic and Islamic Business, State Islamic University of North Sumatra, Mr. Dr. Mustafa Kamangrakan MH, the Honorable, the Head Department of Sharia Accounting, Mrs. Dr. Hajah Yamnisam B. Juliati Nasution, MA. The Honorable Secretary Department of Sharia Accounting, Mr. Hendra Harmain, SH, MPD. The Honorable General Chairman of the Student Association of the Sharia Accounting, Mr. Muhammad Izitama, and the Honorable all of attendees. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahilladzi hadana li hadza wa ma kunna linahtadiya laula an hadanallah. Asyhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la syarikalah wa asyhadu anna sayyidana Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu alladzi la nabiyya ba'da. Puji dan syukur marilah sama-sama kita panjatkan kehadirat Allah Subhanahu wa taala atas limpahan rahmat dan karunia-Nya sehingga pada kesempatan kali ini kita sama-sama dapat mengikuti acara webinar internasional yang diadakan dalam kegiatan Accounting Fair keempat ini. Salawat bertangkaikan salam, marilah sama-sama kita hadiahkan kepada junjungan kita Nabi besar Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma shalli wa sallim wa barik alaihi. Semoga kita mendapatkan syafa'na di yaumil akhir kelak. Amin amin ya rabbal alamin. Tidak banyak ingin saya sampaikan di sini. Saya ucapkan terima kasih terkhusus kepada pemateri kita, yaitu Ibu Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siroj yang telah meluangkan waktunya untuk bisa mengisi pada acara webinar internasional kita kali ini. Kemudian juga saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada seluruh pihak yang telah bekerja keras dan berpartisipasi dalam mensukseskan acara kita pada kali ini, terkhusus pada acara webinar ini. Dan juga saya meminta maaf yang sebesar-besarnya jikalau terdapat kesalahan ataupun kekurangan dalam perhelatan acara kita pada pagi hari ini. Dan kita harapkan semua, semoga dengan adanya acara webinar kali ini dapat menambah ilmu pengetahuan kita dan juga dapat memajukan perkembangan dunia akuntansi syariah. Mungkin hanya itu saja yang dapat saya sampaikan. Lebih dan kurangnya mohon dimaafkan. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah, waridha wal inayah, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Dafa Ulhaq, for the speech. The next agenda is speech by General Chairman of the Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting 2021 till 2022, Muhammad Izitama. To Muhammad Izitama, please, time is yours.
Baik, bismillah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi washabihi rasulillah ajmain. Yang saya hormati Bapak Wakil Dekan 3 Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis Islam UIN Sumatera Utara, Bapak Dr. Mustafa Kamal Rokan MH. Yang saya hormati Ibu Ketua Jurusan Akuntansi Syariah, Ibunda Dr. Hajah Yenisam Ri Juliati Nasution, MA. Hormat saya juga kepada Bapak Sekretaris Jurusan, Bapak Hendra Hermain, SMPD. Dan yang saya hormati juga pemateri yang sengaja kita undang, yaitu Ibunda Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siroj. Dan yang saya banggakan seluruh panitia dan peserta webinar internasional HMJ Akuntansi Syariah. Tak banyak yang ingin saya sampaikan di sini, saya mengucapkan beribu terima kasih kepada seluruh panitia yang dimana telah sama-sama ingin mensukseskan kegiatan ini, dan saya harap kita akan mengadakan sharing-sharing session juga kepada pemateri mengenai bagaimana sih fungsi akuntansi syariah itu terhadap dunia luar. Jadi nanti kita akan ada sesi tanya-jawab juga, saya harap kepada seluruh peserta bisa bertanya dan bisa kita ambil ilmu dari webinar kali ini supaya kita bisa dapat menerapkan dan kita bisa dapat mengetahui bagaimana sih akuntansi di Malaysia sana dengan akuntansi di Indonesia. Tentunya pasti ada perbedaan juga di sana. Mungkin hanya ini saja yang dapat saya sampaikan. Lebih dan kurang di sini saya mohon maaf. Kepada Allah saya mohon ampun. Billahi fisabil haq fasta bikul khairat. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you Muhammad Izitama for the speech. The next agenda a speech by Head Department of Sharia Accounting, Mrs. Dr. Hajjah Yeni Samri Juliati Nasution MA. To Mrs. Dr. Hajjah Yeni Samri Juliati Nasution MA, you might take the floor.
Thank you for the time. Forgive me, I will speak in bahasa. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin, wa bihi nasta'in, wa ala umur dunia wa din, wa ala ahli wa sahbihi wa salam ajma'in, amma ba'du. Segala puji bagi Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mari sama kita haturkan atas semua karunianya kepada kita semua, terutama nikmat iman Islam dan kesehatan, juga kesempatan sehingga kita bisa berkumpul bersama meski menggunakan Zoom meeting untuk mengikuti rangkaian kegiatan accounting terempat AMG Akuntansi Syariah PBIN Sumatera Utara yang dalam hal ini dalam kegiatan seminar internasional. Salawat dan salam kepada Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma shalli wa sallim wa barik alaihi. Semoga dengan senantiasa bersalawat kita semua mendapat syafaat di akhir di hari yaumil akhir kelak. Amin, amin ya rabbal alamin. Yang sama kita hormati dekan PBIN Sumatera Utara, Bapak Dr. Muhammad Yafis MA. Yang sama kita hormati Bapak Wakil Dekan 3 PBIN Sumatera Utara, Bapak Dr. Mustafa Kamarokal MH. Yang sangat kita banggakan Ibu Pemateri, dosen dari International Islamic University Malaysia, Ibu Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj. Terima kasih Ibu di tengah-tengah kesibukannya berkenan menjadi pemateri kami di seminar internasional kali ini. Yang sama kita hormati Bapak Sekretaris Jurusan Akuntan Syariah, Bapak Hendra Harmain SMPD. Terima kasih Bapak sudah berkenan mendukung dan menyempatkan waktu di antara banyak waktu kesibukan yang lainnya. Dan yang kami hormati Bapak Ibu dosen yang berkenan hadir pada kegiatan hari ini. Dan yang terhormat Ketua HMJ AKS 2020-2021 Ananda Ijitama beserta seluruh jajarannya. Dan yang terhormat Ketua Panitia PB Accounting Pair 4 HMJ Akuntan Syariah Ananda Dafaul Haq dan seluruh tim yang sudah bekerja keras dari awal sampai hari ini dan semoga sukses sampai ke penutupan. Semoga kerja-kerja kerasnya sebagai amal jariah di sisi Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Dan yang dibanggakan seluruh peserta yang sudah berhadir dalam kegiatan kali ini dan alhamdulillah kegiatan ini dihadiri oleh 389 mahasiswa akuntan syariah dari berbagai tempat. Semoga kegiatan ini menjadi kegiatan yang memberikan dampak positif untuk kemajuan akuntansi ke depan. Bapak Ibu yang kami muliakan dan Ananda yang kami banggakan, sama kita ketahui bahwasanya di tahun 1642 akuntansi baru sampai di Indonesia dan itu pun dibawa oleh pedagang-pedagang yang melakukan transaksi ekonomi di negara kita. Meski sama kita ketahui kalau akuntansi itu sendiri telah berkembang pesat di Italia. Dan bagaimana perkembangan akuntansi syariah di Indonesia? Perkembangan akuntansi syariah di Indonesia sejalan dengan berdirinya bank pertama syariah di Indonesia, yaitu Bank Muamalat Indonesia sekitar tahun 1990-an atas prakarsa Ijmi dan Mui. Jadi inilah cikal bakal lahirnya akuntansi syariah di Indonesia. Meskipun baru di tahun 2002 muncul ide pemikiran keberadaan akuntansi syariah diakui secara pengetahuan maupun secara teknis dengan dibentuknya Komite Akuntansi Syariah di Indonesia oleh IAI. Anan yang berbahagia, kegiatan seminar internasional ini sebagai sebuah kegiatan yang sangat prestisius karena ini diadakan satu-satunya dan memang dalam kegiatan Accounting Affair. Oleh karena itu, kami berharap ikutilah kegiatan ini dengan sangat baik, karena kita akan mendapatkan pengetahuan baru bagaimana perkembangan akuntansi syariah yang mendorong perkembangan ekonomi Islam di dunia. Dan alhamdulillahnya, hari ini seminar internasional kita ini akan disampaikan oleh pemateri yang sangat berkompeten. Jadi harapan kami, seminar ini diikuti dengan sebaik mungkin sehingga mendapat ilmu pengetahuan yang sangat bermanfaat seperti yang sering kita dendangkan dalam lagu Akuntan Syariah, menjadi juara. Jadi menjadi juara itu perlu ilmu pengetahuan yang mumpuni dan terus diasah, salah satunya dengan mengikuti kegiatan seminar seperti saat ini. Sekali lagi kami ucapkan selamat kepada seluruh peserta dan seluruh panitia yang telah mengadakan kegiatan ini. Besar harapan kami, rangkaian kegiatan Accounting Affair dan salah satunya webinar internasional ini bisa berlangsung dengan baik dan diikuti dengan seksama oleh seluruh panitia, oleh seluruh peserta, sehingga tagline Akuntansi Syariah, cerdas berhitung mengukir prestasi, bisa terwujud di masa-masa hadapan. Dan kami berharap Wakil Dekan 3 PBI UIN Sumatera Utara berkenan memberikan sambutan dan membuka kegiatan ini. Demikian yang bisa saya sampaikan. Mohon maaf untuk hal-hal yang kurang berkenan. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mrs. Dr. Hajah Yeni Samri Juliatina Sution MA for the speech. The next agenda is speech and also officially open the International Webinar of Accounting Fair for 2021 by Deputy Dean 3 of the Faculty of Economics and Islamic Business, State Islamic University of North Sumatra, Mr. Dr. Mustafa Kamal Rokan MH. To Mr. Dr. Mustafa Kamal Rokan MH, you might take the floor.
Thank you very much for thank you for the time. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahilladzi nazzal al-furqana 'ala 'abdihi liyakuna lil-'alamin nadhira. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم فصل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. The honorable for our presenter, the main presenter, Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj, lecturer of International Islamic University Malaysia. Welcome to Medan, Doctor. Welcome to North Sumatra. Thank you for your attention. And we hope, we pray to Allah, Allah always bless you, inshallah. And then the Honorable for the chairman of the Sharia Accounting Department, FEBI UIN Sumatera Utara, Dr. Hajah Yeni Yasamri Juliet Nasution MA. And then the Honorable for Hendra Harmain, our moderator and the secretary of the Sharia Accounting Department, FEBI UIN Sumatera Utara. And then for the head association of children Akuntans, Febi Wensu, yeah, Adinda Izitama, Muhammad Izitama, and the head of the committee for this course, this webinar, Ananda Dafa, yeah. Tentu kita bersyukur kepada Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala pada pagi hari ini kita dapat bertemu, berjumpa, bermuajahah dalam acara yang sangat penting ini, acara yang sangat bergengsi ini, ya. Mudah-mudahan Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala memberikan kita hidayah ilmu pengetahuan, diberikan kelapangan hati dan pikiran untuk mendapatkan ilmu pengetahuan, dan pengetahuan itu kita gunakan dalam melaksanakan fungsi-fungsi kekhalifahan kita, memberikan manfaat kepada masyarakat, kepada umat manusia. Ibu Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj yang kami hormati dan seluruh yang berhadir peserta webinar International syariah accounting yang sangat antusias untuk mengikuti webinar yang sangat bergengsi ini. Tentu kami mengucapkan terima kasih yang sedalam-dalamnya kepada semua pihak yang membantu menyukseskan acara ini, terutama kesediaan dari presenter kita, narasumber kita yang jauh-jauh dari Malaysia, walaupun sekarang sudah terasa dekat di hati ya, karena memang sudah bisa memakai webinar atau memakai online. Mudah-mudahan kerjasama kita dengan IUM Malaysia ini terus berlanjut, dan kami mengucapkan terima kasih atas kesediaan dan kerjasama yang telah dibangun selama ini. Para peserta dan para undangan sekalian yang kami hormati, webinar internasional kali ini mengangkat syariah accounting as the driving force of Islamic finance in the development of Islamic economic world. Yeah. Saya kira tentu tema sebenarnya ini sangat menemukan momentumnya, ya, di mana saat sekarang ini keuangan syariah ya bertumbuh secara cepat di industri keuangan global. Ya. Bahkan dalam beberapa data yang dapat kita baca bahwa pertumbuhan industri keuangan global itu pertumbuhan keuangan syariah melampaui pasar keuangan konvensional. Ya. Dalam Global Islamic Economic Report misalnya tahun 2020 memperkirakan nilai aset keuangan syariah itu meningkat 13.9% pada tahun 2019 ya, yakni dari 2,52 triliun US dollar menjadi 2,88 triliun US dollar. Selanjutnya pada tahun 2021 misalnya, sejalan dengan tren global yang meningkat, keuangan syariah di Indonesia juga tumbuh positif di tengah pandemi seperti yang masih kita rasakan pada saat sekarang ini. Misalnya dari sisi perbankan, pada Mei 2021 aset perbankan syariah di Indonesia itu tumbuh 15.6% year on year atau mencapai 598,2 triliun. Ya. Tentu perkembangan keuangan syariah ini menuntut kepada kita semua, apakah sebagai akademisi ataupun sebagai praktisi, untuk membantu atau bisa sejalan dengan perkembangan keuangan syariah itu sendiri. Dan seperti kita ketahui bersama bahwa ilmu akuntansi, ya, apakah kita labelkan dengan syariah, bahwa ilmu yang terlama, saya kira ya, ilmu yang terlama yang telah dilalahkan oleh Allah Subhanahu wa taala dalam Al-Qur'an surah Al-Baqarah 282 itu, ya ladzina amanu idza tadayantum bidaini ila ajalin musamma faktubu. Saya kira ini ilmu ekonomi pertama yang diberikan Allah kepada kita agar memang mencatat itu, dan itu menjadi ilmu akuntansi yang kita pelajari
dari generasi yang
ya, jadi ilmu
terdepan. Kita menjadi orang yang seperti ya. Orang yang
ada apa nih? Ada
kesempatan yang lain. Seperti kita ini gitu. Jadi harapannya pada kita yang sudah mendapatkan ini,
narasumber yang kami hormati, Ibu Dokter, kemudian juga kepada undangan dan para mahasiswa sekalian. Oleh karena itulah momentum webinar kali ini menjadi sangat penting bagi kita untuk mengasah ilmu, khususnya ilmu akuntansi. Indonesia, ya, kita kenal dengan salah satu tokoh ilmu akuntansi yang menjadi panutan kita, yang kebetulan juga orang Medan, ya, orang North Sumatera, orang Halak kita bahkan, ya, Marga Harahap. Profesor Dr. Sofian Sapi Harahap, walaupun telah berpulang ke rahmatullah, mudah-mudahan Allah memberikan kelapangan dalam kuburnya. Kita khususnya UIN Sumatera Utara, Febi UIN Sumatera Utara, harus bersemangat, ya, mempunyai ghirah tersendiri untuk mengembangkan ilmu akuntansi, karena memang anak-anak sekalian khususnya bahwa pakar atau pionir ilmu akuntansi syariah di Indonesia itu orang Medan. ya marga hara pula lah gitu ya. Nah, ini apa tulangnya Bu Kajur ini. Ya oleh karena itu semangat ini harus kalian pupuk dan saya kira HMJ Akuntansi hari ini telah menunjukkan kiprahnya yang sangat luar biasa dengan mengadakan accounting fair yang salah satunya adalah melakukan kegiatan webinar yang hari ini atau sedang kita laksanakan ini. Oleh karena itu saya terus mendorong kepada kita semua dekanat dan seluruh pimpinan FEBI UIN Sumatera Utara sangat menyambut baik dan bangga terhadap kalian yang telah mengadakan seminar ini dan mampu mengundang narasumber yang sangat ternama, narasumber yang sangat kompeten bagi kita dan insya Allah kita akan menimba ilmu pengetahuan dari narasumber kita yang berasal dari IIUM Malaysia. Oleh karena itu, atas nama pimpinan Dean of Syariah and Economic Faculty, ya, Bapak Dr. Muhammad Yafis yang dalam hal ini sedikit berhalangan, ya, karena ada acara khusus bagi beliau, mengucapkan terima kasih atas segala bantuan, segala partisipasi, khususnya kepada adik-adik sekalian yang berjibaku untuk melakukan atau melaksanakan kegiatan ini. Dan demikian juga khusus kepada Ibu Kajur, Ibu Yeni yang begitu terus mendorong adik-adik kita untuk melakukan kegiatan-kegiatan yang sangat bermanfaat. Dan demikian juga dengan Bapak Sekretaris jurusan yang ini Bapak Hendra Harmain yang saya kira menjadi tawasul kita ya. Menjadi hubung kita yang begitu sangat antusias dan banyak memberikan kontribusi yang sangat luar biasa bagi perkembangan FEBI dan khususnya dan kepada UIN Sumatera Utara pada umumnya. Jadi Bapak Dr. Hendra Harmain ini juga adalah salah satu nominator ya. Wahdatul Ulum Award pada tahun ini ya. Nah, insyaallah pada tahun-tahun yang akan datang Bapak Hendra Harmain akan mendapatkan Johan dari Wahdatul Ulum Award yang diadakan oleh UIN Sumatera Utara. Atas semua pihak yang telah membantu ini, sekali lagi kami ucapkan terima kasih dan khusus kepada narasumber kita, Dokter, kami mohon maaf jika ada kekurangan dari kegiatan anak-anak kita ini, Dokter. Mudah-mudahan Dokter memberikan kemaafan dan dengan ikhlas memberikan ilmu pengetahuannya kepada kita semua. Ala kulli hal, mari kita berserah diri kepada Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah lah yang maha punya ilmu. Sesungguhnya tak ada ilmu kita ya illa qalilah hanya sedikit dan mari kita dekatkan diri kita kepada Allah Subhanahu wa Taala dengan dekatnya diri kita kepada yang punya ilmu maka insyaallah kita akan diberikan secerca ilmu dari yang maha punya ilmu al-alim zat Allah azza wa jalla. Mari kita berserah diri kepada Allah mengharapkan ridha-Nya dan kita buka dengan asmanya pada kegiatan webinar internasional pada hari ini mari sama-sama kita membacakan al-basmalah bismillahirrahmanirrahim semoga Allah Subhanahu wa Taala terus memberikan hidayah kepada kita terutama hidayah ilmu pengetahuan khusus pada hari ini kita mendapatkan banyak pengetahuan berkaitan dengan ilmu akuntansi dan perkembangan keuangan syariah sekali lagi mohon maaf dan terima kasih saya akhiri dengan billahi taufiq wal hidayah wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you to Dr. Thank you to Mr. Dr. Mustafa Kamarokan MH for the speech. The next agenda, reciting of the prayer that will be brought by Khairul Rahman. To Khairul Rahman, please, time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد سر حياة الوجود والسبب الأعظم لكل موجود صلاة تحفظنا بها القرآن وتفهمنا بها الآيات تحفظنا بها سوء القول والعمل والنيات وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا ولوالدينا وارحمهما كما ربيانا صغيرا ولأستاذنا ولمعلمينا ولجميع المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم انصرنا فإنك خير الناصرين وارزقنا فإنك خير الرازقين وافتح لنا فإنك خير الفاتحين واغفر لنا فإنك خير الغافرين اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى ونسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وقنا عذاب القبور وقنا عذاب المحشر سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you to Khairul Rahman for reciting the prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, now we will start our session on the International Seminar of Accounting Fair 4. We would like to welcome Mrs. Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj as a lecturer of the KEMNS International Islamic University Malaysia. And she will interviewed by Mr. Hendra Harmain SA MPD as Secretary Department of Sharia Accounting. To Mr. Hendra Harmain SA MPD, you might take the floor.
Thank you for Askar Rayani.
Begini Pak, izin Pak ya. Jadi nanti pada saat sesi diskusi kita, nanti akan ada door prize bagi 3 penanya Pak. Nanti Bapak bisa pilih 3 penanya itu Pak.
Oke.
Okay. Ingin menginformasikan sedikit, Pak. Ya.
Untuk Bu Yeni juga bisa memilih salah satu.
Ya, boleh, Pak. Terima kasih, Pak.
Thank you for Aska Rayani. We are please coming to speak Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj. Assalamualaikum, Dokter.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Puji syukur kehadirat Allah Subhanahu wa taala yang telah memberikan rahmat dan hidayahnya kepada kita semua sehingga kita dapat melaksanakan acara webinar internasional dengan tema Sharia Accounting as a Driving Force of Islamic in the Development of the Islamic Economy World. Speaker Dr. Siti Alawiyah binti Siraj TGA-TAM in lecture IIM in Malaysia Faculty Kuliah Ekonomi Sains Management in Jadi Dr. Siti Alawiyah ini adalah tidak asing lagi bagi UIN Sumatera Utara, khususnya Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis Islam. Dokter ini adalah salah satu pembicara juga waktu mahasiswa kelas ekonomi dan sistem prodi akuntan syariah berkunjung ke IAIN Jember. Dr. Maria Lehman dan Dr. Nur Ain, Profesor Dr. Nur Ain. Jadi prodi akuntansi sangat berperan bagi prodi akuntansi syariah. Terima kasih dokter. Sebelum kita mulai acaranya, saya akan kasih pantun sedikit. Hari ini sangatlah indah dalam acara Akunting Fair keempat bersama narasumber Dr. Siti Alawiyah. Kita mendengar dan mengambil ilmu yang bermanfaat. We invite to speaker Dr. Siti Alawiyah bin Cisirat. Please, Dr.
Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Honorable Deputy Dean Tree, the Faculty of Islamic Economics and Business, UINSU, Dr. Mustafa, yeah, and also to the Head of Department of Syariah Accounting, Dr. Hajah Yeni Samuri Juliati, yeah. So I hope I pronounce the name correctly. Okay, and also to Bapak Hendra Harmain, the Secretary of the Syariah Accounting Department, representatives from other faculties in of UINSU, the Head of Students Associations, and of course the participants. Yeah. I was informed they are coming from 10 universities across Indonesia. Yeah, I'm really overwhelmed with the participants. I think it's about to reach 400 here participants. It's really overwhelming with the excitement from the students. Yeah, and of course from the organizer who really worked hard. Yeah. Thank you very much for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to reconnect or to connect with UINSU. I have been meeting with Bapak Hendra for a few times, yeah, during his visits to IIUM, both his official as well as personal visits. Yeah, Bapak Hendra also dropped by when he made his personal visit together with his family members. Yeah, it's a very instrumental and touching to us. And actually, I am basically though like Dr. Mustafa mentioned just now, it's very far, but now it's close to UINSU. Yes, indeed. Yeah, I hope one day I'll be able to meet all of you face to face to visit UINSU. Yeah, because I am also very close to Indonesia. I basically, yes. My background is also from Indonesia. My ancestors are coming from Indonesia, and if you can see my name, yeah, Siti Alawiyah is actually inspired by Tuti Alawiyah. Yeah, my father told me that when he was about to give name to me, at that time Tuti Alawiyah was very active in radio, if I'm not mistaken. So he was inspired by that, wanting me to be like her, I believe. Yeah. So I don't know whether I have already reached his expectation or not. Yeah. But I am very close to Indonesia, by the way. Although I don't know whether I have got still family members in Indonesia, but yeah, that's our route. Yeah. When we are talking about our route, we are always very happy to talk about it. Yeah. Okay. That is about about my introduction to make. I mean, this is very hard actually to talk to people. Just online. Yeah, I think
I think some of the lecturers feel that, some of lecturers feel okay, but I always feel uncomfortable because we do not actually meet, we don't know actually how the reactions of the participants and all that, yeah. But hopefully everyone will be okay with the presentations that I'm going to be doing. Allow me if I can share the screen, yeah, because I have screens, and I am given, if I'm not mistaken, I'm given like 25 minutes, Papa Hendra. Yeah. 25 minutes. So I'm not really sure, yeah, whether I can share the screen now, yeah?
Yes.
All right, okay, thank you. Right, but I'm really sorry because my computer has got problem with the RAM, so I'm not able to use this slideshow, but rather just looking the using the working slides. Yeah, so I hope it doesn't mind for all. This is the topic given to me by Bapak Hendra when he contacted me like few weeks ago. So I thought like okay, but when I about to prepare my presentation, it's like, you know, it's a mind boggling to me because it's a long topic, it's a big topic. Yeah, it is indeed a big topic, and if you look at the topic, you know, the three main elements. Yeah. The three main elements of Islamic economics are all there. Yeah. So it's Sharia accounting, or in Malaysia we call it Islamic accounting, and then Islamic finance and Islamic economic world. It's not Islamic economic, but you all are basically looking at a bigger aspect, a bigger ecosystem, which is Islamic economic world. Yeah, so yeah, I'm trying my best, all right, to discuss about it. I would like to apologize in advance if, let's say, my discussion is not in line with the expectation of all participants and also the organizer and the participant actually. Yeah? Okay, so so let's see what I will be presenting today within the given time period. I'm looking at the title. I'm very much sure that I'm not able to discuss everything. So I'm going to be discussing based on my involvement in the Islamic finance. Sort of Islamic finance that I am involving. Yeah. And this is what I'm going to be sharing with everyone. Rather than, you know, expert, I think I will just share what I have experienced. Yeah. So if you look at the title, this is not all right. I'm trying to dissect the title so that I would be able to discuss, yeah, the title that will benefit the audience. Yeah, hopefully it meets the expectations of the audience. Like when the title is given like Sharia accounting as a driving force, so it means Sharia accounting must be actively involved in the ecosystem. Okay, so this is what is expected, I believe, to be discussed. Yeah, all right. But at the same time, okay, the end objective of why Sharia accounting or Islamic accounting need to be actively operationalized or actively involved is the very end objective of anything, of everything that we are doing in the ecosystem, is that basically we want to have Islamic economy. We want to have an economic system that embrace Islamic values, economic system with which are embedded with Islamic objectives, yeah. And within this Islamic economics, there are other elements, yeah. For instance, Islamic finance, to be very specific. Okay, these are all talking about money, yeah, but it is not actually in Islamic economics. So I hope I will be able to explain, yeah, how Sharia accounting, okay, what are the course of action, yeah, need to be done within the Sharia accounting, or as what most of you are referring as akuntansi Sharia, okay, as a driving force to make sure that, you know, the Islamic finance will be working towards the achievement of Islamic economics. Because at the end of the day, what we want out of the Islamic economics is, you know, the al-falah for everyone. Okay? So I hope this is going to be able to explain about the topic. All right. So I always, from the accounting lens or accounting perspective, but I always see, you know, the main role of Sharia accounting or accounting per se is to actually provide information. Yeah. Provide information, while you see Islamic economics is more on providing or developing, establishing policies. So this is, if you look at this one, okay, of course this is not like bottom up, top down, but you can see like policies, economic policies, how Islamic economic should be operating. It is actually coming from this part here. All right, so ensure that the sustainability of the policies, that's where the Sharia accounting should be functioning, yeah, by providing information which are relevant, information which are timely for them to make sure that the policies are implemented, work, are acted upon sustainably. So in between, we have Islamic finance, which I would rather refer this part here as the operator of the Islamic finance, yeah, the operator, the institutions itself. Okay, so hopefully that helped you to understand the overall title, how I'm going to bring you in this presentation. Okay, so hopefully I'm not trying to be, you know, like a class. I'm going to be very quick, yeah. But when we are talking about Islamic economics, let me share, you know, the very, there are many definitions of Islamic economics, but I think I am comfortable with this definition by Prof. Habib, yeah, which is, well, it is the science of the study. It is a body of knowledge, okay? That will be basically a study or discussing about the best possible use of resources. Why is it best possible use of resources? Okay, well, in Islam we always have the resources to, we have limited resources because our resources is not that lavish, yeah, in Islam, limited resources, and that resources should be used optimally, yeah, should be used optimally. And not only that, we want to make sure that everything is within the boundary of the Sharia, yeah. And I with that, I think it is also good to share the overall framework, yeah, on Islamic economics, where the Islamic economics is within the whole framework of Islam, yeah. So I think, I believe everyone is aware that, you know, in Islam, we have three important elements of Sharia, Ahlak, and Akidah, which basically covers the being of a person, yeah, and the being of a person in this dunya, yeah, like Sharia govern the practices and activities, how we interact, yeah, with a human being, how we basically handle our businesses, for instance, yeah, these are within the Sharia. Well, they are, I mean, in ensuring that we are always within the boundary, you know, we are basically also bound by the faith, yeah, faith and belief, which basically referring to the main reference in Islam, yeah, our faith and belief, we have our tawhid, yeah, these also bind the Sharia and also the akhlaq, yeah, the moralities and ethics, yeah. And under that we have ibadah and also muamalah. So the Sharia, the practice here, we are talking about our relationship with Allah, yeah, specific ibadah, our salah, yeah, our fast, our hajj, yeah. And the other part here, which is what we're going to be talking, is this is man-to-man relationship, our muamalah, yeah. Our muamalah. So there, under this muamalah, there are various other aspects of muamalah, but we are focusing into economy, yeah, the economic muamalah. And under the economic muamalah, interestingly, there are other sectors, broken down into three sectors. Okay, this is referring to Dali et al. Eh? Sorry, the word all is not there, 2008. So we have public sector, this is, they call it public sector, is the CSC, yeah, the CSC sector. The finance sector is the tijari, and the social sector is known as ijtimaiyah, yeah. All right, so let us have a look at the major functions, okay. I'm not going to be focusing in others. But if you look at the tijari sector and ijtimai sector, okay, so tijari is the, I call it the private sector with, that we are very familiar with, basically to create wealth, yeah, this is to create wealth, while the ijtimai sector is more on ensuring the social security among the ummah, yeah, or Islamic social security. All right, institutions that falls under these sectors, okay, of course, these are the CSC sector or the public sector, mainly the governments, yes, the central governments, the state's government. I think in Indonesia, they call it provinsi, yeah, provinsi, and there could be some other statutory bodies, yeah, this is bodies under either central government or state government and also state-owned companies, yeah. But looking at these two sectors here, okay, which is, I think this is a sector that we basically are interested in today, is, you know, look at the institutions here, private owned entities, yeah, like for instance, financial institutions like Islamic banking, Islamic banks, sorry, takaful, yeah, and also perhaps syarikat or partnerships, cooperations, yeah, like for instance, in Indonesia, there's a institutions known as Baitul Mal wa Tamwil, yeah. It could be under tijari, this Baitul Mal wa Tamwil together with wakaf. It could be depending on the nature of the operations, okay? Because wakaf is a very flexible. It can be a tool to create wealth. Right, but of course the wealth is, it's, I mean, the operation must be within the boundary of what we call it Islamic welfare, yeah. It is not to it's not really to make profits like other profit maximizations entities. All right, if looking at the institutions, I mean, Baitul Mal, this is in the context of Malaysia, yeah. Baitul Mal in the context of Malaysia is actually functioning as a social security institution. That means taking care of the welfare of Muslims, yeah. Zakah, this is a mandatory social sector, yeah. Is obligated upon all Muslims, of course, depending on the hajj, yeah, or the threshold. Wakaf, yeah, wakaf can be part of the social security sector as well. Initially, it was mainly for the purpose of social social welfare or social security. But the current development, I think it is not just in Malaysia, but I believe in Indonesia of, as well, they are moving towards the tijari sector. Okay, because to sustain the social security of the Muslims, I mean, wakaf can play a role in that. Okay, that is I believe Khalid, the audience are very well aware of that. Yeah, and the other one is sadaqah. This is general security. So this is I hope this gives you an overview of the Islam economic system. All right, the sectors within the six within the system. So in other words, if let's say the whole system is governed in an Islamic way, so we have these three sectors together in the Islamic economic system. Yeah. So remember, the government also part of the system. Of course, the private sector and the third sector or the social sector. So anything that cannot be provided by the public sector and the economic sector, that basically rests on the social sector. So basically, this is the role of the public sector. And now, with the increasing expectations from the public and the and the limited resources by the government, basically government are resorting to the private sector and now increasingly to the social sector, to help maintain and sustain the whole ecosystem, or to help maintain and sustain the economy. All right, I don't want to deal very much with the objectives, which I believe that everyone is aware of this, in terms of the objectives of Islamic economics, which eventually at the end of the day, what we want to have, what we want to have is Allah. When we the success, which is not just here, but at the end of the day is the success in the next world. That means our deeds are accepted. We will be happily living there, but of course for us to be able to be in that state, well, we have to to do to make sure that our activities, our mu'amalah, especially when we are talking about the economic mu'amalah, is always within the boundary of Islam. So we are talking about economic fair and equitable distributions, necessity. We're talking about necessity or needs fulfillment. It's not the extravagant fulfillment, optimum usage of resources. This is very, very important because we don't want extra things. So we make sure that everything is optimally used. Tak ada pembaziran, in other words. That's why you can see maybe the other in other occasion. There will be discussions on how management accounting helps in ensuring this optimum usage of resources through planning. From the Islamic perspective, that is not much being discussed. More discussion on accounting. It's really focusing on the accounting and reporting. And of course, the good thing is that in Islamic economics that we are upholding the individual freedom to have based on their efforts, there's equal rights and opportunities. And these are the principal characteristics of Islamic economics, which in other words, what needs to be there if you were to operationalize the Islamic economics, making sure that every single activities would be lawful, in other words, halal. There's no riba, no interest and riba, no gharar. There's no khalid, tak ada penindasan, contohnya. There's no hoarding, keeping idle or squandering individual wealth. Always sharing. We have the mechanism to share the surplus of wealth in our economic system, either voluntary or or obligatory, yeah, the wakaf, the sadaqah, the zakah, yeah, these are all the mechanism which is within the Islamic economic system. And that's, I think, very much related that, you know, to prevent, yeah, the accumulations of wealth just within a few hands. Yeah, you can see now in our economic system, there's the gap between the wealthy, yeah, or the affluence and those who are within the Asnaf group or the poor are getting bigger and bigger. Yeah, so that is the problem that we are having now. All right.
So
social justice without inhibiting enterprise. So this is basically an overview of Islamic economic system. This is what we want to achieve at the end of the day. Okay. This is what I mean. What the Islamic accounting, it should be. Should be pushing the Islamic finance. The, you know, we will see, you know, which entity within the Islamic finance. Okay, so this is what we want to achieve. Yeah, in the Islamic economic system. So knowing that, understanding the principle, aware of the objectives, what we want, because what we want really shape or frame what we're going to be doing. Yeah, for instance, we know what we want to achieve at the end of the day under the banner of Islamic economics. So that's going to be our target when we are doing anything, including the Sharia accounting. That's going to be the objective. Yeah. So let us see our bridge, the bridge that will bring us to achieve the Islamic economy. Okay. So we are based on what we understand the Islamic finance system is going to be the bridge to bring us to have the Islamic economics. Okay. So, Islamic finance or Islamic finances or Islamic financial system or Islamic finance system. Okay? It's always being aligned to when people talking about Islamic finance system, it's always being aligned to talk about or towards financial sector. Yeah? It's always towards the financial sector. When you are talking about financial sector, what come across the mind is always the Islamic banks. Islamic banks and now takaful and Islamic capital market. That is always, of course, is a big sector there. Yeah, if you're talking about Islamic financial system, financial sector constitute the biggest sector. Yeah, the biggest chunk, or they have the biggest cake, yeah, as just now mentioned by Dr. Mustafa. Yeah, same goes with the Islamic finance in Malaysia. Yeah, Islamic finance in Malaysia, we started as early as 1963 with the establishment of our Hajj Fund, yeah, or Tabung Haji. Which initially started as a very, we'll call it a very simple objective, to help all the Hajj pilgrimage to keep their money, to deposit their money, so that, you know, the money is being separated from their personal use, to make sure that, you know, once the money is kept in the Hajj fund, you know, they don't take it out, and then it will be there. And it will accumulate it. That is the first, the very simple objective of Hajj Fund, and that really, it becomes a catalyst in the Islamic financial, in the Malaysian Islamic financial sector in 1963. Yeah, that was really, really long time ago, right? So at that time, the knowledge of Islamic accounting is zero. Okay, is zero. The objective is just to keep the money for Hajj purposes. But over the time, Alhamdulillah, all right, being a catalyst, and then you know, the commitment of the those who have the political will, yeah, and then we move to another instrumental development with the establishments of Bank Islam, yeah, the first Islamic bank in Malaysia, okay, the Bank Islam in 1983. It was not a very, it wasn't a smooth sale, yeah, for the Islamic financial sector in Malaysia. But now we can say, although it is not that in comparison with the other conventional you know, financial sector, but yeah, it is considered to be a successful. Yeah, it's considered to be a successful. We are recognized as one of the important hub for Islamic financial as well. Yeah, we have, for instance, in the Islamic capital market, we have issued Sri Suku. Yeah. Islamic bond, okay, but I have to be honest to every one of you that in this part here, the financial sector here, I am not the best person. Yeah, I am not the best person because my involvement is mainly in the other sector of the finance, yeah, Islamic finance, which is a non-financial sector. This is, although, I mean, over the last 10 years, this non-financial Islamic sector is nowhere, yeah, was nowhere in Malaysia. But over 10 years after I did my PhD, Alhamdulillah, it is not because of me, but I mean, the momentum started in 2010, somewhere there. Again, it is from the party who has that political will. All right, so the development of Wakaf and of course Zakat and Baitul Mal is very encouraging. Yeah, for instance, in the last budget announcement 2021, the government the government has allocated certain amount of funds, and they establish Pelan Pembangunan Wakaf Nasional. Yeah, and they expect like in the end of 2021. At the end of, we have a, you know, Malaysia plan, at the end of 2025, they expect to have Wakaf asset worth 1.3 trillion. Yeah, that is what they forecasted. Yeah, so I mean, that development in Wakaf is very encouraging for me in Malaysia. Okay, same goes with Zakat. Zakat has been in the non-financial sector system for quite some time, yeah, in Malaysia. I think that also happened in the case of Indonesia as well. Baitul Mal in Malaysia is not very significant as compared to Baitul Mal Watang Wil in Indonesia, because of the Watang Wil part in Indonesia, that makes Baitul Mal in Indonesia is a very institution, especially in terms of the microfinancing sector. Yeah, so because I have supervised students doing research on this Baitul Mal Watang Wil. Okay, but Wakaf is very is very encouraging. Like for instance, our one of our ministries has used Wakaf, cash Wakaf, yeah, to raise funds for the purpose of developing our water distribution system. That is done at the level of the ministry. It is not done at the level of state. It is not done at the level of agency. It is not done at the level of non-governmental organization, for instance. But that is the level of ministry. In other words, Wakaf has been recognized there as one of the financial tool, yeah, to develop the economic system, right? Now, this is one example, but And I've come across in Indonesia as well, there's a involvement by the finance ministry, yeah, by the finance ministry, and in taking wakaf as one of the Islamic financial tool, yeah. And I came across also our colleague, yeah, Prof. Salina is going to be talking in one of the seminar conference webinar, yeah, webinar, obviously webinar on Islamic finance, the role of Islamic finance in Indonesia, and the Ministry of Finance is going to be there, yeah. So that means this recognition by the government, yeah, who has that political will, recognizing wakaf as one of the Islamic financial tool, yeah? Contributing, it's going to be contributing towards the whole economic or ecosystem, yeah, the economic ecosystem. Okay, so this basically, and this is why, okay, this is why, you know, because I can see here the importance of the non-financial sector here in contributing towards the development of the overall Islamic finance system. And at the end of the day, this will be ensuring the whole economic system will be Islamic, yeah, will be Islamic. And these are basically, it is part of the Islamic finance system. They have specific prescriptions for wakaf and zakat and certain part of microman. So if we develop this, okay, according to what has been described, so definitely it will be expanding, or it will be making sure that, yeah, our economic system will be observing the Islamic values. Okay, so I'm really sorry if I focus more on this non-financial sector, which I believe this is also an important sector that we, the Muslim accountant, should not leave it just by that. Yeah. In other words, we have to also starting to focus on this non-financial sector. Okay. So if you look at the scope of Islamic accounting, this is basically in line with the earlier slides. Yeah. So our scope of Islamic accounting, of course, we are dealing with Islamic banks methods, takaful. Yeah. This is the financial. Okay. And private entities as well, but the zakah, wakaf, all right, would be under the non-financial sector. Okay, they are in Malaysia, for instance, they are institutions, Islamic institutions, which are also part of the government institution because of the governance sector, because the governance of that institution in Malaysia, like for instance, the Islamic affairs is under the state government, but the state government is basically a government. Then in Malaysia, if you're talking about wakaf and zakat, they are institutions that is under the government. They are wakaf and zakat institution that is just by itself, but generally, most of it is under the government Islamic institutions, yeah. And there are also Islamic non-governmental institutions like charities and society, and also societies. So these are the scope of currently, yeah, the current scope of Islamic accounting, which means if you're talking about Islamic accounting, we have to address the Islamic the accounting issues under each of these institutions, yeah. I mean, we can't afford to neglect or to ignore any of this because they have their contributions. Okay, for instance, if you're talking about non-financial institutions, they are actually the main contributor towards the third sector, which is the ensuring the social security of the public, the social security, especially of the Muslims. And if you're talking about wakaf, it is transcend Muslims community. It is basically for everyone. Yeah. All right. So another one that we may be considering is the crowdfunding. In Malaysia, crowdfunding is getting its prominence. Yeah, crowdfunding. So we may want, to also look into the crowdfund, the Islamic issues of crowdfunding as well. Yeah. Although it may be quite similar with the accounting issues of for cash wakaf, for instance, but cash wakaf, sometimes cash wakaf are purely for social and welfare objectives. But if you're talking about crowdfunding here, crowdfunding, what has been formalized and everything in Malaysia, most of the crowdfunding are mainly for profit making purposes. Yeah. So these are the scope of Islamic accounting. So I hope that from now onwards that when we are talking about Islamic accounting or Sharia accounting, I'm using a mixture of Sharia and Islamic accounting, of Sharia accounting, we must take into account these institutions. What are their issues? Because like wakaf and zakat, there are specific requirements with regards to the accounting, yeah, which needs to be addressed. Same goes with takaful and also Islamic banks and other anything to do with Islamic institution, there are specific issues. Specific issues with regards to the accounting or the recognitions, as well as the disclosure, means the reporting. All right. So this one here, Sharia accounting here. So I'm just Google to see, how relevant is Sharia accounting. So, but I use the word Islamic accounting. Yeah? I don't use the word Sharia accounting because generally this is what is, it is not that I do not recognize Sharia, the word Sharia, but because generally they are using the word Islamic accounting, yeah, rather than Sharia accounting. So if you, this is an additional results last night, yeah, when I Google the word Islamic accounting, there are altogether 30 million 200 results within 52 seconds. Can you imagine the search, the people, the interest of people on Islamic accounting? And the first statement of Islamic accounting that I found in the Google says that Islamic accounting is an alternative accounting system. Now, this is from what they conclude. Yeah. Well, it's okay, fine. But what is more important is that we want the word down here according to Sharia. Yeah. According to Sharia. This is what we want. They can say alternative accounting system. That's fine. But what is more important is about the compliance to the Sharia, yeah, or Islamic law. Okay, and other things you can see varies on AOF, of course, one of the accounting standard issuer, yeah, account AOF, and you can see numerous journals, articles, websites on Islamic accounting. This is to see, it is not just us, but the public, that's the overwhelm interest of people towards Sharia accounting or Islamic accounting. Yeah? So in terms of history, is I think everyone knows, the history of accounting is not just during our time, because it went back during the Khalifah Omar, and then talking about the Diwan. Yeah? I believe if you read the history of Sharia accounting or Islamic accounting, you will be coming across with this. Yeah, the Haraj by Qudama, yeah? And also Al-Kashkandi here talking about the requirements of Al-Khatib or the accountants. Yeah, so they impliedly you're talking about fake mu'amalah, trustworthy and respectable. And there are other things like you know, like for instance, just now, it is a very interesting sharing, yeah, by the head, Dr. Hajah Yeni, when she said, you know, when accounting arrives in Indonesia in 1642, yeah, and that is basically brought by the people who came from the West. Okay? So I believe it is almost the same time when Malaysia had their first accounting records, yeah. So because we are almost the same at that time. Okay. Now what are the rules of Sharia accounting? What we need to do as Sharia, as accountants or as the advocates of Sharia accounting? So we have to go back to the very basic definitions of accounting itself, or of Sharia accounting itself. We have to go back to the very basic definition to understand what are the role, how are we going to go about, okay? So that's basically will frame our activity, and that will help us to frame what we should be doing. How are we going to do basically if we were to make it as a driving force to push fast, Islamic finance to make sure that, you know, the Islamic economics will be achieved. So one thing is that when we are talking about accounting, we can't run away from talking about information because that's the job of the accounting. Okay. When I'm talking about accounting, in any way, because I also involved with the policymaker, but they could hardly understand because they say, what you all are doing, we are providing information. The information will change the landscape of the financial ecosystem. The information, the timely, the accurate information, yeah, that will change, yeah. The how successful is the Islamic finance system, okay? And of course, when we talk about Sharia or Islamic accounting, so the information is bound by the Islamic Sharia. Okay, and later I will be talking about, and that's where we have to deal with that. And another important roles of the Sharia accounting, it is a tool for accountability. This is might not be seen, yeah, explicitly when you're talking about tools of accountability, especially to God. But if you link back, okay, with the objective of Islamic economics, which is to reach Al-Falah, that's where the role of Islamic accounting is very important. Yeah, to make sure that we will be demonstrating or discharging our accountability, not just to, you know, to the employers, to the employee, or to the explicit stakeholders, to the human being. No, it's not just that, but towards Allah, and that's where the Al-Falah will be achieved. Yeah, that's where the Al-Falah will be achieved. So it is very instrumental for that. Right, so and one thing, when you're talking about Islamic accounting, the role of Islamic accounting, how are we going to, you know, work to make sure that it, you know, function as a driving force, we have to identify, we have to know who are the users of the accounting information that we produce. Are we able to meet the demand of the demand of the stakeholders or the users of the accounting information? Are we able to not just to provide information, but the information that is very much needed for them, yeah, to make decision, for instance? Although Islamic accounting, when you're talking about Islamic accounting, the first objective is for the purpose of accountability. But remember, accounting always help decision makers. Yeah. So these are among the, you know, potential users of Islamic accounting information. information or Sharia accounting information. This is quite common. You're talking about credit investors, you're talking about creditors, regulators is important here. Sharia supervisory board is important. But when we are talking about the public stakeholders within Sharia accounting, we have added, we have additional users. Beneficiaries, yep. Beneficiary for wakaf and zakat, customers is a common, and also donors, donors and contributors for wakaf and zakat. So it needs to be, it needs to be taken into consideration seriously. Yeah. Okay. Once you have understood the role of accounting, and then also the uses of Sharia accounting information, which you are gonna be, you know, generating informations for them. Okay, making sure that what their demand will be fulfilled. Okay, now we go to the course of actions. Yeah, if you want it to be a driving force, if you want to make sure that accounting, accounting is gonna be instrumental towards the Islamic finance and also towards the Islamic economics at the end of the day. This is based on my observation and experience, yeah, engaging in the development of you know, accounting standards for wakaf, zakat, and matumah. So one thing is, of course, the commitment of the government, commitment of the government, commitment of any party that have the will, political will especially. Yeah. So the first thing is issuance of specific and relevant accounting standards for each sector. So you know, I mean, you're talking about the bigger sector is the financial sector is the financial and non-financial. So yes, it needs to have a specific accounting standard that address their specific Sharia requirements. Like for instance, you know, the recognitions of revenue and expenses, the recognition of assets and liabilities, trust fund and equity. Based on my experience developing the accounting standards for the non-financial sector, okay, these will be this is crucial. Like for instance, zakah, all right, zakah. It has been in Malaysia. I'm not really sure about in Indonesia. It has been for so long being recognized as revenue for the zakat administrator, but conceptually it is not that accurate. Yeah, conceptually. So that sort of thing. Will zakat have assets, for instance? Because that concept will have impact on how we treat those, whether we are treating them as trust fund or equity. Yeah, so this need to be addressed carefully because eventually it will have impact on the, you know, on the performance of the institutions itself. And also accounting standards or needs to be relevant with the contemporary needs of accounting and reporting. If let's say now people are talking about the other part, are talking about integrated reporting. So we also need to address that integrated reporting for the Islamic institutions. Okay? Now people are talking about SDG reporting, SDG costing, SDG budgeting. Yes, we need to also develop those, yeah, SDG reporting, SDG costing and budgeting for the Islamic institution. So we need to be always relevant, yeah, so that we can always compete with the other system, which is a conventional system. If we are lagging behind this, we don't talk about integrated reporting for our wakaf, zakat, baitul mal or impact Islamic bank, maybe. We don't talk about SDG reporting, right? We are going to be lagged behind because there's nothing wrong with SDG reporting. Basically, we are addressing on the security of the people. Yeah, we can talk about the security of our ummah. And then engagement with regulators, stakeholders, with political will is very important to make sure that we are always visible, yeah, in the economy. And also this this is, I would say, addressing the current technological advancement like artificial intelligence, big data, blockchain. So this is also very crucial to make sure that addressing accounting in this area or integrating, embedding this in our accounting math issues, big data, how we're going to be using all the information available to improve our reporting, for instance, to use blockchain, for instance, to improve the reporting, the timely reporting, for the purpose of performance evaluation, because we want to be together, we want to be at par with the conventional one, And the last one here, which I think you all are here, basically, proactively educating agents of change. This is very crucial. I mean, this needs to be continuously done, I am overwhelmed with what university in Indonesia, basically, they are basically proactively educating agents. Imagine 390 agents that you all are educating, and this is going to be spreading throughout Indonesia. They will have compounding impact, inshallah. And that's where we want to always want to have. Okay? So inshallah, this is going to be continued by the Indonesian University. And we are actually inspired by all of you, actually. So hopefully, this is a sharing and learning, and inshallah, I'll be bringing back this, seminars, webinars, to our students back home, in Malaysia. Okay, I have meet the time, but quickly I want to share, this is comparison in Malaysia. So to see in terms of the non-financial sector, which I am familiar with, like Wakaf, Zakat, Baitul Mal, at this Watamwil, Indonesia has far ahead than us. They have come up with the statements of financial accounting. Correct me if I'm wrong. This is what I've been I'm talking with my students. These are the standards that they are using. But Malaysia is still developing. We are still developing. I mean, it's a shame to us, but alhamdulillah, we are also moving. Inshallah, make dua for us. It's just that in Indonesia, I think what needs to be done is for the Baitul Mal Watamwil, because it is actively providing microfinancing to basically to the customer. So it needs governance in terms of the accounting. And at the moment, they are using the conventional corporations, corporasi. So which is not really addressing the specific Sharia requirements, because they have Islamic contracts when they are offering financing to the people. Okay, in terms of Malaysia experience, so with the development of Zakat and Wakaf over a decade, so and also numerous researchers, that basically trigger the political will of the Accountant General Department, and it initiated a nationwide research with us, the academia, and also engaging with the main stakeholders in Malaysia, especially the State Islamic Religious Council. It's very difficult in Malaysia, because each individual state will have its own power or jurisdictions when it comes to managing Wakaf, Zakat, and Baitul Mal. So Accountant General Department really put a huge effort to engage with them to make sure that they're going to be accepting these accounting standards. The effort is just so huge. So hopefully make dua for us that the standards will be well received by Zakat, Wakaf, and by Tulma institutions. And hopefully, we can learn each other on that. All right. So and you see, it's gonna just be expected to be completely rolled out in 2025. It's not a short journey. It's a very long journey. It's almost a 10 years journey. All right. So because we actually come up with a with the standards by itself. We're just trying to learn from the Malaysian public sector accounting standards, because these institutions are under government, but there's a specific activities. Whatever the standards that you are preparing, basically this is a framework. Yeah, the framework that at the end of the day, we are talking about Islamic accounting or Sharia accounting, basically, I mean, we have the same objective, which is aligned to the objective of the Islamic economics. This is if we are talking about alignment, congruence, I mean, this must be ensured. Yeah, because if our objective of Islamic accounting is not aligned with the objective of the Islamic economy, that means we are not supporting them and we are not going to be the best driving force. Yeah. Other than this is the operationalization, so that is all, but I'm basically stressing on this one here. So we are talking about Tauhid and we are guided by the Maqasid Sharia as well. Yeah. So I think that is all on my presentation. So thank you very much. So I shall stop here. I'm really sorry. I have, used up quite a lot of time. All right. Thank you very much. Bapak Hendra, I think I'm handing over back to you the session.
Thank you very much, Dokter. Sekarang kita masuk ke acara sesi tanya jawab.
Oh, yang pertama ini, ya?
Ya, kita akan ada dua orang yang dari langsung ingin nanya sebelum kita ke ruang chat.
I try to answer. If I am able to answer, I will answer. If not, I'll bring back to discuss back with my colleagues. Yeah, going to give a wrong answer. So if I can answer, I will answer. Okay, to be fair, yeah. Sharing knowledge, so the right knowledge, I have to impart the right knowledge. Okay.
Okay. Siapa yang ingin bertanya langsung sekarang boleh raise hand sebelum kita lihat ke ruang room chat.
Sir.
Oke, silakan. Oke, silakan.
Thank you for moderator, Mr. Hendra Armaiti, MPD, for giving my question. And special thank you for Dr. Siti Alawiyah Sirkyu, for Miss or Mem Yeni Samri Juliatina Nasution. We discuss about the Islam in my question. How do we spread the Islamic finance system? Well, now once our holding world finance is conventional. It's enough, sir.
Sorry, sometimes I find it hard to understand. Kalau in Indonesia,
boleh,
how you
boleh.
You because you okay. Said finance system, and then
di slide 9 kita kan berdiskusi tentang Islamic 9. Finance system.
Okay. Okay.
Nah, di situ timbul satu pertanyaan saya mengenai kondisi kita saat ini juga gitu. Nah, pertanyaan saya yang timbul itu dari slide 9 yaitu bagaimana cara kita menjadikan Islamic system Indonesia ini menjadi nomor satu. Sementara pada saat ini kondisi keuangan itu dipegang oleh konvensional, tidak konvensional gitu. Itu saja pertanyaan saya. Saya kembalikan kepada moderator.
Boleh saya jawab terus? Can I respond to that?
Please.
Your questions, Brother Fajri Mustafa Akbar, yeah. So
yes,
in IUM, we always address the guy as brother, yeah. Okay, your question is not supposed to be posted to me. I think it should be posted to the Ministry of Finance. Yeah. How to make it? How to make Islam as a main financial system in a country? Is that what you are trying to ask, Brother Mustafa? Okay, that is a very good question. And I think this is also the aspirations, yeah, of everyone who is who advocate the Islamic finance, yeah, Islamic finance, Islamic economics, and of course we the accountants, yeah, who actually advocate the Islamic accounting or Sharia accounting. We want it to be the main system that regulate our economic system. This is my personal opinion. Yeah, this is my personal opinion. You may have a different opinion from your docent. Yeah, okay. But my personal opinion, since we are actually, in Indonesia as well as in Malaysia, we are running what we call a dual economic system. Yeah, a dual economic system. One is the conventional system and the other one is the Islamic system, yeah, Islamic financial system or Islamic economic system. I mean, this is to be practical. Need to be practical that, you know, because in our country there are various people, okay. We cannot really enforce them, okay? Unless if the government can do that, yes, we can enforce them. But okay, to make sure that the Islamic economic system is going to be heading the economic system in the country, this is where the role of us, every one of us, yeah, to act as a change, to act as an agent for change, yeah. We might find it like, well, this is not important, or we might find it like, is it possible? Yes, it is possible. Okay, although the time that we may take is may not a short or an overnight, yeah, but we need to act. Yeah, we need to act. And this is, I think, why you all are having this this international webinar. Bapa Hendra and Ibu Yeni, they are working hard to change you, to make sure you as the agent of change, yeah, so that because without us, I mean, we cannot achieve the Islamic economic system. We are the one who run the Islamic economic system. But from the very simple thing, like we are depositing our money in the Islamic bank. Yeah, we are depositing our money in the Islamic bank. With that, we are actually increasing. Yeah, we are accumulating, we are actually expanding the value of the Islamic economic system. Yeah, the value of the Islamic capital market, directly or indirectly, perhaps. Even a small amount, yeah, that is very important. If we don't act that from, if that action is not coming from us, I mean, you can talk 10 years, in 10 years time, but it won't move. That's why I think I am really overwhelmed this kind of seminars, yeah, because this seminar disseminate the idea. I mean, when Islamic accounting was first discussed, like in the early 1990s, during that time, yeah, early 1990s, I mean, they have lots of disagreements, people don't, I mean, when the Islamic Bank in Malaysia was first instituted, I mean, well, they are not well-received at that time. They were talking like, but it's a difference between Islamic bank and non-Islamic bank. We are still in the same system. Yeah, we are still, I mean, it's in the same system. But when we know the spirit of Islamic bank, that, you know, the spirit of the Islamic economics basically is bringing us to the right, objective of life. It is not just, you know, you want to have free interest, free of riba, but you know, you have to know the real spirits of Islamic economy is to bring us to the right life in the hereafter. Yeah, this is where you have to really act as the agent of change. We, for instance, in the IIUM has numerous Indonesian students. Yeah, Indonesian students had their postgraduates, masters, and also PhD. They become the agent of change in Indonesia. Yeah, that is my opinion. And when we are aware of that, then only we can surpass, yeah, the conventional. Simply talking is not enough. So we have to act as an agent. That's why you say I'm pretty much agree with the topic saying, the title saying that, you know, Islamic accounting must be the agent or the driving force. We have to move. Right. I think that is all. Thank you very much. I hope it answers you, brother.
Thank you, Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj. Persepsinya sama sih dengan saya, dan saya memahaminya. Terima kasih. Saya kembalikan.
Thank you very much, Fajar Mustafa. Bila kita akan memasuki program master di akuntansi syariah ada di IIM untuk program master and PhD.
Yeah, yeah. Ramai, you know, our Indonesian friends, yeah, they had graduated and then, you know, alhamdulillah, yeah, we share the same spirit, yeah, alhamdulillah.
Oke, okay, nanti kita dari Fakultas Akuntansi, Prodi Akuntansi Syariah akan berkunjung ke IIM untuk studi
sekursi. Yeah, welcome. We really appreciate that. We want more accounting students, yeah. Because I mean, we have quite a number for finance and also for economics. So we would want to have more of accounting students because we want to strengthen the governance of the Islamic financial system through accounting. Yeah. So, being accountant, we always believe that accounting plays an important role in strengthening the governance of the Islamic financial system.
Okay. Terima kasih, dokter. Selanjutnya kita akan lihat di ruang chat dari Ibu lecturer in UIN, Dr. Camilla. Assalamualaikum, Mr. Would you like to explain more, please, about political will and regulation in Malaysia related to Hajj fund management system for the best
political will.
Yes, with the cat room cat, Dr. Camilla.
The chat room. Oh, okay. Is it political will and regulation in Malaysia? Yeah. In Malaysia related to hedge fund management. Okay. Thank you very much for the questions. So I will try my best to answer this question. Yeah. This is Ibu Dosen. Yeah. Bapak Hendra.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Okay. Alright, okay. Salam perkenalan ya, Ibu Camilla ya. So hope we will be able to meet face to face ya, insyaallah. Okay, with regard to hedge fund ya, it was established a long time ago in 1963, and then it is now is regarded as it was established under one legal act. So when it's established under one legal act, so that act is basically regulating the whole governance of the tabung haji or hajj fund. So now its function is not just basically as a place for the deposits or for the hajj, but it is now expanding. So tabung haji is now operating as a commercial institution. So it has plantations. Like I think the last few years, we have Indonesia and Malaysia. We are sort of like had argument about the jerebu or haze problem. But alhamdulillah, recently we no longer have that haze problem. Most of the plantation that we have is actually in Indonesia. The tabung haji, invested in palm oil in plantation in Indonesia. So and it is not just plantation that had also expanded its business into properties as well, property management, food and beverages. So that's basically helped to create more wealth to the depositors. Of course, tabung haji just not now is not just depending on the individual depositors, but also the institutional depositors. The institutional depositors here would refer mainly to the government-linked companies, like we have Petronas, we have our investment company, like our employees provident fund. So we have institutional investors that help basically tabung haji. In terms of that is basically how it the operations of tabung haji now. Governance, it is still under the government. Tabung haji is still under the government. It is considered as one of the government statutory body. So it is still subject to the Ministry of Finance rule and regulation. So in other words, they can operate as a business entities, but within a certain limitation. This is to ensure that the money deposited by depositors, either from the individual or from the institutions, will be guaranteed. Will be guaranteed. That is something which is actually attracting depositors to put the money in tabung haji, rather than in other institutions. Because depositors or deposits in tabung haji is basically guaranteed by the government. So if, let's say, anything happened to the tabung haji, for instance, depositors will get back what they have deposited. That is the interesting part of tabung haji. Well, political will, when you talk about political will, I think when you are talking about anything that is related to government, it needs to have a political will. Somebody that has power, needs to have that, for instance, the accounting standard for wakaf, zakat and baitul mal. I mean, academics in Malaysia has been writing papers in journal articles, in newspapers, talking about the problem of accountability reporting of these institutions. We don't have any power, we just write, but basically that creates awareness. But alhamdulillah out of those papers, perhaps one of the paper, I don't know whose paper, basically has triggered the one of the initially triggered Malaysian accounting standard boards. The issuer, the institutions or agency that issue accounting standards, but this accounting standard is for the basically for corporations. Since MASB doesn't have the authority, so then it passed to the MASB passed to Accountant General Department. That's where Accountant General Department initiated. That is top down. Okay. So when you talk about this, you need top down. Like in Indonesia, the the appearance or the visibility of the Ministry of Finance in events on Islamic finance, the other day on Wakaf seminar, is very important. That's where, I mean, if possible, you all need to have engagement, close engagement with her. Yeah, and I think her engagement with this kind of events also is out of head. Hopefully, it's out of her, you know, her inspirations to see the role of the non-financial, the Islamic non-financial sector would be recognized, yeah, in Indonesia. Okay, I think that's it all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You too.
Does it really answer your question?
Sure. Thanks so much.
Singapore also has already, Singapore, Indonesia has got its fund now, yeah? Tabung the Hajj Fund. It is led by Professor Adnan, yeah? Adnan.
Sekarang Prof. Adnan adalah BPKH, anggota BPKH Haji.
Pengelola
keuangan haji.
Badan pengelola. I like the word pengelola there. Because pengelola means he is just, you know, mengelola. It is not owning.
Prof. Ahyar Adnan.
Yeah, Ahyar. Prof. Ahyar was in IIUM for quite some time.
Okay.
This is an example of agent of change, yeah?
Yes. Next, in chat room, from Muhammad Al-Farubi. Assalamualaikum. What are the challenges in education of Islamic finance in digital area?
Ah, digital area. Okay, the challenge, yeah? What are the challenges and challenges and education of Islamic finance in the digital era? Okay, I don't know whether I could answer your question. Challenges, there are two questions actually here. One is challenges of Islamic finance, challenges of Islamic finance in digital era. The other one is the education of Islamic finance in digital era. Because the word end there. Unless if you, yeah, there are two questions. I think educations, it is not just Islamic finance education, but I think the challenges is like what we have now in digital era. But of course, what I can say when you are talking about Islamic finance, like just now I outlined, you know, what need to be done is to incorporate or integrate with the advancements, yeah, in the information technology. How I would be able to help, you know, the Islamic finance, automated investment. I don't know. Yeah, I'm not really good in that. How blockchain, for instance, incorporating blockchain in the syllabus. Yeah, blockchain and also incorporating data analytics as part of the syllabus in the Islamic finance. I think it has been incorporated in some of the universities here in Malaysia. I'm not really sure, but surely I have come across webinars, seminars in Indonesia that they have already talking about the AI, the blockchain, data analytics, yeah, in zakah management, yeah, zakah management, and also work. I think Basnas have taken a bold step, yeah, in incorporating those in their operations in certain instances, yeah, and they have actively having conferences, yeah, I mean, the head is going, I mean, have a very close relationship with zakat institutions. Yeah? I mean, cooperations with the private sector that have expertise on this area is very crucial. Yeah? Very crucial. That is to ensure that, but challenges are there. Yeah? I mean, we are still struggling in terms of the concept. But again, we are already being exposed to this, you know, fast development in the technology. But we can't afford to just leave those technology behind. We need to together, right, incorporate, yeah, those elements in the syllabus so that our agent of change is able to grasp all those things when they are in the field. Yeah. So we know, I mean, the agent of change will be able to use big data to for their decision makings. Yeah, for instance, for the, you know, for the better operations of the financial institutions. A challenge is there, I think. I mean, it needs to be always keeping abreast with the development. In the digital era, yeah, and this is, I mean, online also, we need to, you know, we cannot like step back and then I'm like almost retiring and I just leave, you know, you cannot do that because we need to always keeping abreast with any technology, yeah, and I think the young people like you all will be able to do it very fast. Okay, do not ignore technology. We can't afford to be tight. I think that's all, Bapak Hendra.
Okay, ada dua lagi, Prof. In chat room, yang pertama, bagaimana menurut dokter perkembangan akuntansi syariah di Indonesia?
Oh, di Indonesia, ya? Yeah?
Indonesia.
Okay. Okay. This is a hard question actually, because my engagement and observation is basically just based on journal articles. Yeah, my engagement based on journal articles and a few participations as participant in webinars. Okay. But I am very much as this is when I want to say whether it is okay or not okay, I need to have a comparison. Yeah, when I'm comparing with Malaysia, I think you are really you are above Malaysia. You all are above Malaysia. You are very fast. We are still struggling, okay, but you all have already got the standards, for instance. That is one step. And another step is to enforce, yeah, of course, enforcing the standards, okay, making sure that the standards is being observed, yeah, and then use informations produced based on standards will hopefully be used for the purpose of decision making for the betterment of the whole system. Yeah, it is not just use and cap, yeah, but the information must be used for the purpose of decision making by the relevant stakeholders. That is important because we don't want, like, you know, coming out with standards and reporting based on standards, but the information is not going to be used. It is, I know it is hard, you know, but I think we need to, that's why we need agent of change. Yeah? We need agent of change.
Okay, doctor. Last question.
Right.
Bagaimana bisa menjadi akuntan yang hebat gitu, menurut
yang
dokter?
Hebat. Akuntan yang hebat.
Okay. Kemudian bagaimana bisa Malaysia menjadi number one untuk turis Muslim? Dibanding
Muslim,
ya, food halal,
Oh, halal hab. Halal hab. Okay, yeah, the one that is tourist Muslim, I think I'm not the right person to answer lah, yeah. Because I'm not directly involved in the tourism, yeah. Halal, in terms of halal, if you're talking about halal institutions, governance for halal, I can talk a little bit, like we have, you know, institutions like the state Islamic Religious Council. They actually regulate the halal aspect in their respective states. So in other words, they're gonna have halal certifications. Yeah, like for instance, one of the states, Kedah, for instance, you know, the halal certification will be not just to food product, but on every aspect of the activities, which I think that it should be. Yeah, and we have institutions for halal as well. Yeah, that is very. You know, but in ensuring that, I think Malaysia has, you know, embraced the maqasid of Sharia in most of the aspect. We try to map, yeah, our activities with the maqasid Sharia. So with that, I believe, yeah, if everything is mapped against that and it's basically fulfilled the maqasid Sharia, I mean, you don't have to worry about the halal, yeah, the halalness of the activities, yeah. But of course, we are always very particular and cautious about the food as well in Malaysia. Okay, going back to being an accountant, yeah, to be a great accountant. I mean, a great accountant, it is hard. I think Bapak Hendra can explain that on the great accountant. Yeah? I mean, great accountant is very much depending on an individual's as well. Of course, they are accountant is a profession by itself. So when it is a profession by itself, it is regulated, yeah, generally by a certain code of ethics. Okay. Well, conventional have got its own code of ethics. For instance, you have to be competent. That is competent, knowledgeable, have integrity. Those are common values that needs to be upheld, yeah, by accountants. Accountant must always preserve those morals and ethics. Okay, Islam as a Muslim accountants, those even is, you know, should be given a serious attention, because we accountant is the one who will be doing the accounts. That's gonna be accounted, yeah, accounted, and being accountable to Allah. That is account. We accountants who are the person who account for anything that is, you know, being practiced, okay, or anything that you transact, right? And we have to always be accountable. So if you have that, you know, you have that value in yourself, I mean, you will be a great person. Because if you remember, whatever that you do as an accountant, it is not just to be accountable to your employer, but you are also being accountable to Allah directly for what you are doing. Yeah, that is the whole story of accountant. That's why I, in my class, I always say, you know, accountant, what is accountant? An accountant is a person who accounts for, who accounts for all accounts, okay? And to be accountable, not only to the employers or shareholders, okay, or stakeholders, but more importantly is to Allah. And that accountability to Allah is actually framing the whole thing about yourself as an accountant. That is all I, if you were to be a great accountant. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sesuatu yang sangat menyenangkan pada hari ini yang bermanfaat bagi kami. Ilmu. Thank you for sharing your knowledge to so that it will be useful for Osborne Youth ETS, collector at IIM, and hopefully will always be healthy. For to dokter, semoga dokter sehat-sehat selalu. Terima kasih ilmu yang sangat bermanfaat. Yang bisa saya simpulkan di sini adalah bagaimana sarjana akuntansi syariah itu mempunyai etika dan adab dalam berkomunikasi, dalam mencari ilmunya di manapun berada. Semoga ilmu yang dokter sampaikan sangat bermanfaat bagi kami, dan kami ingin sharing ilmu langsung bertatap muka di IIM.
Insyaallah, insyaallah.
Sehingga mahasiswa kami ini bisa melihat dunia ini sebenarnya bagaimana, tidak hanya di Indonesia.
Yeah, exactly.
Terima kasih.
Can you say a few words before I leave?
Okay, please.
Right. I would like to thank everyone for your time listening to my presentations and also sharing. I would say more on sharing what I have experienced here and also observed. So it may not be actually totally answering or discussing the title given to me, but I hope it gives some exposure or some insights of what is happening in Malaysia, okay? And also some insights for us to act as as the students of accounting, and also who advocates the Sharia accounting. And always believe that our role is very importantly is as the agent of change, so that, you know, at the end of the day, what we want is the Bapak Hendra has given the title to me is that, you know, Sharia
accounting
will be able to push to the achievement of Islamic economics one day. Yeah, it is not a total Islamic economics. At least we are going to be surpassing the conventional economics. Okay, thank you again, Bapak Hendra, for being like Bapak Mustafa just now said, the tawasul, yeah, for between me and UIN. I am really looking forward to visit. My apology for any shortcomings during my sharing sessions. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dokter. Selanjutnya, kini ada kita akan melihat tiga pertanyaan kepada Ibu Head Department of Accounting, Ibu Ajayani Samri.
Terima kasih Pak Moderator. Yang pertama mungkin menurut saya itu Pajri Muhammad Akbar, Pak.
Satu. Ya.
Terima kasih Bapak.
Boleh dokter pilih mana pertanyaan yang bisa dianggap bagus, dokter? Yang apa tadi pertanyaannya, mengenai apa? Topik pertanyaannya, topik question-nya. Oke, langsung saja kita pilih Gustia Rizki dan Nisa Zahra. Gustia Rizki dan Nisa Zahra. Nah, itu dari pertanyaannya yang mendapat draw prize hari ini dari panitia. Oke, terima kasih. Saya sampaikan kepada para audiens yang berhadir ini sampai sekarang 359 orang. Semoga ilmu ini dapat audiens terapkan nanti di kemudian hari, dan inilah cara akuntansi syariah dan bersama HMJ membuka mata kita bagaimana kita tidak hanya di dalam Indonesia saja, kita bisa melihat keluar di negara Indonesia, dan ilmu-ilmu ini sangat bermanfaat. Sampai di sini, terima kasih. Saya akan kembali ke MC, kepada Aska Layana, dipersilakan.
Thank you, sir. We want to say thank you to Mrs. Dr. Siti Alawiyah Siraj for the very inspiring seminar, and also thank you to Mr. Hendra Harman, SAMPD, for guide our discussion for today. Sebelum itu, saya ingin meminta kepada moderator untuk melakukan foto bersama terlebih dahulu. Jadi untuk para peserta webinar diharapkan untuk menghidupkan kameranya ya, karena kita akan melakukan sesi foto bersama. Bagaimana operator, apa sudah di SS?
Bentar ya, ada beberapa lagi. Tapi dia masuk, tapi dia ini.
Mungkin bisa dikasih aba-aba ya, Kak, biar pada tahu nih. Dari slide keberapa aja.
Udah
di screenshot semua ya, Kak? Oke, baik, terima kasih kepada operator. Ladies and gentlemen, we now come into the end of this event, the International Webinar of Accounting Fair for Student Association Department of Sharia Accounting 2021. On behalf of the host and committee, we would like to extend once again deepest appreciation to you all for your support in participation. We wish you stay healthy. I want to apologize for my mistake in my word on my behavior as long as I am the master of the ceremony today. And to Allah I ask forgiveness. Tebal bulunya si beruang kutub, cairan es ia jadikan minum. Sebelum acara saya tutup, saya ucapkan wassalamualaikum. Akhirul kalam, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, dokter. Sehat-sehat selalu.
Enggak.
Terima kasih Bapak Hendra, Ibu Yani ya. Oke.
Terima kasih, Bu. Amin. Insyaallah kita
ketemu. Kafat tak ada dah ya?
Ada, Bu.
Oke. Terima kasih, minta maaf ya. Insyaallah kita ketemu.
Terima kasih. Amin. Banyak Ibu.
Terima kasih banyak Ibu. Mudah-mudahan kita dan bisa ke IUM.
Tak discuss soalan, tak discuss title ya. Okay. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Oke, kami tolak izin dulu lah ya.
Ya, saya. Okay, saya minta izin dulu ya. Okay.
Ya Ibu, dokter. Terima kasih.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih ya kepada panitianya. Terima kasih Bapak,
Mak Bu. Enggak
bisa bahasa Inggris.
Enggak ngerti bahasa Inggris.
Izin lab juga ya. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.